assume likelihood attacks or masked and shuffled implementations. The co-authors are Nicolas Brunet, Robin Guillon, Annalie Hauser, Olivier Hure, François Xavier Condard, and Yannick Deglier. And Nicolas will give a talk.
Do you hear me well?
Yes.
So thank you for this nice introduction. So in this talk, I will present you our result on Taylor expansion of maximum likelihood attacks. The maximum likelihood attacks are known to be the best attacks, but in some cases, they can be really inefficient. And in this presentation, I will show you a new attack with a better efficiency. So this work is a joint work with my advisor, Sylvain Guillet, from Telecom Paritech and SecureIC, from Annelie Heuser from IRISA and Telecom Paritech, but also with Olivier Rioul from École Polytechnique and Telecom Paritech, with François-Xavier Standert from UCL, and this work has been done while Yannick Teglia was at ST. I will begin this talk by an introduction on sidechain analysis. Sidechain analysis are classical threats against cryptographic algorithms, and as a consequence, countermeasures have been developed. These countermeasures are themselves the target of particular kinds of sidechain attacks. In this scenario, when the attacker wants to apply the best attacks, we'll face the issue of the high complexity. And in the second part of this presentation, I will show you a new attack which kept the good properties of the good effectiveness of the optimal attacks, but with a better efficiency. I will then illustrate this new attack in a practical scenario. So sidechain analysis are a classical threat against cryptographic algorithms in embedded systems. They aim at revealing the secret data, such as the secret key, by exploiting the physical leakages emitted by the device during the execution of the algorithm. These leakages can be, for example, the electromagnetic emanation, or the power consumption, or even the heat. And as a consequence, some countermeasures have been developed. One of the most classical countermeasures are the masking scheme, as their security can be formally grounded. The rationale of an omega minus one order masking scheme is as follows. Any sensitive variable will be randomly split over omega shares using omega minus one random variables, random value called the masks. The impact of these two countermeasures is to make the first omega minus one order moments independent from the key. And as a consequence, if an attacker wants to attack such scheme, he should at least look at the omega moment. Another classical countermeasure is the shuffling. The idea of shuffling is to randomize the order of execution of independent operation in the algorithm. And this countermeasure needs a random permutation denoted in this talk by pi. So if in a normal implementation, we will start by use the value z1 followed by z2, z3, and z4. In a shuffle implementation, we will, for example, start by z3, followed by z1, then z2, and finally z4. The classical way to defeat such countermeasure is to make the sum over all the shuffled variables. And the consequence is that we add some noise, so the extrinsic noise, which are the algorithmic noise, which are the non-targeted values, and but so we also add all the extrinsic noise, the noises of the variables. These two countermeasures depend on some parameters. The most important parameters for masking scheme are omega, which is the number of shares. This number is strongly linked to the number of masks. If we want to have omega shares, we need omega minus one masks. The other important parameter is the order of the implementation. It's the minimal key dependent statistical moment. At best, we have O is equal to omega. And if a masking scheme meets this property, it will be called a perfect masking scheme. In this talk, we assume that all the masking schemes are perfect. The most important parameter in the shuffling implementation is this, the size of the permutation, denoted by capital pi. These two countermeasures can be defeated by the template attacks. Template attacks are a particular kind of side-channel attacks. They are known to be the most powerful in an information theoretic sense. Such attacks can be divided into two phases. In an offline profiling, the leakage model is learned and by using a golden device in which we can modify the value of the keys. It exists different methods to perform this estimation. There is the non-parametric method, such as the histogram or the kernel method, or the parametric method, for example, the mixture models. The second step of the attack is to recover the key using the model learned during the offline profiling and by applying the maximum likelihood attacks. So I will present to you in this slide the main advantages and disadvantages of parametric method and non-parametric method. In parametric method, the only random part is the noise. It means that, in general, these methods are easy to estimate, as we can only compute means or variance. But because we assume that the only part is the noise, we assume that the shuffle and the mask are known. This means that we assume here a powerful attacker. And the other drawback is that it can lead to many templates. In non-parametric methods, the shuffle and the mask are part of the noise. And as a consequence, it's not need to know them. But this method can be difficult to estimate, as they may suffer of the curse of dimensionality, which is a common issue in machine learning and statistics. So in this presentation, we assume that all the models are perfectly known and estimated using parametric methods. In this presentation, the attacks are applied on Q queries, which are the leakage measurements, so the traces, and on D leakage sample. This value D is called the dimension of the attacks. Each leakage measurement can be modeled by a deterministic part and a random noisy part. The deterministic part, Y, is a function of a secret key, K star, a random plain text, T, which are n-bit words. But it also depends on some random values, which are the value used by the countermeasure, such as the mask and the shuffle. And in this presentation, these values are denoted by a capital R. The random noisy part is assumed to be a white random Gaussian noise with sigma square as variance. When the models are perfectly known, so we have shown in our 2014 ASIACRI paper that when the model is known, the optimal distinguisher, meaning the distinguisher that maximizes the success rate, is the maximum likelihood. It consists in maximizing the sum over all the traces of the log likelihood. And we can see that in this formula, this expectation here is applied on R. So it's applied on all the mask and all the permutation. And in this presentation, for convenience, we have denoted by gamma the SNR, which has 1 over 2 power of 2 sigma square. Now, if we look at the complexity, we can see that its complexity depends on the number of traces, Q, on the dimension of the attack, D, but also on the number of possible shared values. This value comes from the expectation over the masks, but it also depends on the possible permutation, which comes from the expectation over the permutation. And if the size of the permutation, pi, is high, this term, pi factorial, became huge. And as a consequence, the optimal distinguisher will not be computable due to its high complexity. So in this part, I will present you which is our main result. It's a rounded version of the optimal attacks, which kept the good properties of effectiveness of the optimal attacks, but with a smaller complexity. As already mentioned, The optimal attack consists in maximizing the sum over all traces of the log likelihood. But using the cumulant decision networking function, we can rewritten this formula as the sum over all traces of this series expansion. The series expansion depends on the value kappa, which are the high-order cumulants. The high-order cumulant can be expressed recursively using lower-order cumulants and the high-order moments. Now we can introduce our new attack, which is a rounded optimal attack. This attack depends on a parameter L, which is an arbitrary choice of the attacker. So our new attack is the rounded optimal L-degree attack, consists in maximizing the L-order Taylor expansion in the center of the log likelihood. In other words, we take the L-first terms of the previous expansion, series expansion. So we can see that the term used by the maximum likelihood is equal to the sum of the term used by our new attack, and an error term where the small o is the Landau notation. This means that this error term is small compared to gamma to the L when the SNR is small. If we now look at the complexity of this new attack, we can see that this attack, the complexity still depends on the number of possible shared values, so the expectation over the mask, the number of traces. But it also depends on two factorial terms. These terms depend on the dimension of the attack, on the degree of the Taylor expansion, so L, and the size of the permutation. And we can notice that when the degree of the Taylor expansion is small compared to the dimension of the attack, these two factorial terms are small. And as a consequence, this complexity is also small. So I will now illustrate this new attack in a practical scenario. As case study, we have chosen the case of a masking scheme with a shuffle table recomputation step. So it exists different implementation of masking scheme. They mainly differ by the way the non-linear parts are implemented. Indeed, the implementation on linear parts are quite obvious, but the implementation on non-linear one are more difficult. So we can cite the algebraic method, which exploits the algebraic representation of the non-linear part. We can also cite the global lookup table method, which all the values for all the possible masks are stored in a global lookup table. But we can also cite the table recomputation method, which precomputes a mask Xbox stored in a table. This method are often used in practice as they represent a good trade-off between space memory complexity and time complexity. Moreover, recently, this kind of implementation has been extended to high-order masking scheme. So the sketch of table recomputation algorithm is as follows. In the first part, the table is recomputed, and then it's the classical mask cipher. In the recomputation, we go from all the possible entries of the table and mask the input and mask the output. This kind of algorithm can be defeated by classical second-order attack. But it's known that better attacks will take into account the leakages of the table recomputation. A first example was given by Pan et al. In 2009, which recovered the mask by a first horizontal attack and then recovered the secret key by a first horizontal, first vertical attack. But a better attack is to apply the maximum likelihood and take into account all the leakages of the table recomputation and the cipher in once. In order to protect such implementation against this attack, the classical contour measure is to randomize the order of execution in the table recomputation, and it will need a random permutation here, phi. And here we are in the case of shuffling. So, of course, this kind of algorithm can be still defeated by exploiting the leakages of the classical cipher, so by building bivariate attacks. So, for example, we can apply the second-order CPA, or the optimal distinguisher are, as in this case, no shuffling is involved. But we can also apply our new rounded optimal attack, for example, at degree 2 or 4. So we can see in this figure the success rate expressed on the number of traces. So first of all, we can notice that the optimal attack here is the better attacks. We can also notice that our new attack at degree 2 and the second order CPA perform similarly and are close to the optimal attacks. But the interesting fact in this figure is that our new attack at degree 4 is not as good as the other attacks. This means that in this case, we have added some term in the Taylor expansion, which not make the attack better. And this is due to the fact that in this case, the noise, so for standard deviation is equal to 1, is not high enough to have a good approximation of the maximum likelihood by the Taylor expansion. Now, if the noise increase, for example, if sigma is equal to 2, we have still the success rate expressed in the number of faces. We can see that all the attacks perform similarly and are close to the optimal distinguisher. Of course, a better attacks will take into account the leakages of the table weight computation. In this case, the optimal distinguisher is not computable due to the term in 2 power n factorial. The first example of attacks which target shuffle table weight computation have been presented in CHESS 2015. It's the multivariate attack on table weight computation, and it's a third order attack. And we can also, in this case, apply our new rounded optimal distinguisher. We select as degree 3. As we know, there is third order leakages because of this attack. We can now study the complexity of this case study. So we can see that, of course, the optimal distinguisher is not computable due to this high factorial terms. And we can also notice that our new attack is longer to compute than the multivariate attack. But we will see later that it will be give better results. Now we can see this figure, that for noise sigma is equal to 3, we can see that the new attack, R up to 3, and the multivariate attacks perform similarly and are better than the second order CPA. This means that in this case, the most important term in the Taylor expansion is the third degree one. Now, when the noise increases, for example, for sigma is equal to 12, we can see that now the second order CPA is closer to our new attack. And we can also see that it's much better than the multivariate table weight computation attack. This means that in this case, the important term in the Taylor expansion is the second degree one. But we can also notice that because the new attack is better than the second order CPA, the third degree terms have still an impact. Now, for intermediate noises, we can see that for sigma is equal to 8, for example, our new attack is much better than the attack of the state of the art, as it needs 2 times less traces to reach the same level of success rate. For example, for 80% of success, we need around 60,000 traces to reach 80% of success for the new attack, while the other attack need around 120,000 traces. For other value of noise, we can see that the gain is smaller, but still, our new attack is much better than the attack of the state of the art. We can see in the figure the number of traces needed to reach 80% of success depending on the noise variance, on the noise standard deviation. And we can see that in all the noise scenario, our new attack is better than the attack of the state of the art, as this curve is below the curve of the multivariate attack and the second order CPA. So as a conclusion, we have shown in this presentation a new attack, which is a truncated version of the theoretical optimal distinguisher, which become efficient. This means that now the attacker can manage this attack, it can compute, and remains effective. Indeed, this attack is, in the case of the shuffle table weight computation, always better than the attack of the state of the art. Now the question arises is how to quantify the accuracy of the approximation. So in other words, how to choose the degree of the Taylor expansion. Indeed, we have seen that the good choice of the degree of the Taylor expansion will depend on several parameters, such as the noise variance, the dimension of the attack, and also, of course, the parameters of the countermeasure. So we can imagine that it will be a trade-off between the effectiveness and the efficiency to choose the good parameter. And it will be an interesting task to do this for a generic countermeasure implementation. So I hope we will have some questions, and thank you for your attention.
And the speaker. Any questions or comments? Yes?
Build the model, the deterministic part, and then there's a noise. What happens, what variation is there between one chip and another chip in the deterministic part that makes the distinguisher then accuracy go down or not work anymore?
Ah, sure. So we have done all our tests, assuming that, of course, the model are perfectly known. This means that we have no process variation between the two devices. And if it's the case, of course, there will be an important impact on the effectiveness of the attack. So it will degrade the result of the attack, of course.
Were there any results in practice with this kind of strategy?
So yes, we have some practical results. So we make it on software with Natmega with two different cards. Sorry. And in this case, we have matched the result we see here, exactly the same. We have no so much difference between the two set of faces. So it was okay, but it doesn't mean in general it will be the case.
Thank you.
Yep. Are there any other questions or comments? I wonder if your attack gives advantage also for the case of applying just masking without shuffling. If you have the case.
So if we have no shuffling, in fact, we are close to these cases. And in this case, of course, our new attack is close to the second order CK. So the advantages are small. But we can also imagine other scenarios where the devices leaks in different orders, so we can exploit second order attacks, but also third order attacks, and so on. And we guess that in this case, this approach will lead to better results than, for example, the second order CPA alone.
Uh-huh. And how many degrees do you think are practical to check?
So in fact, it will depend, because in this case, we can easily check the higher order degrees. But now, for the multivariate case, we have to establish the exact formula of the Taylor expansion, and it's quite difficult in practice. So it's for degree three, it's okay. For four, it became difficult. So of course, if we have term, we assume here the result will be smaller, but better. But I think in this case, it will be the best case.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments? If not, let's thank the speaker again.